Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to St. John, New Brunswick. Playoff time with the St. John Mill Rats take on the Moncton Miracles. Best of five series. Going to be a barn burner. I'm saying that because every single game this season has been down to the wire. We've seen half-court shots. We've seen to win the game. We've seen a shot from the three-point line to win the game. Every game has been close, but a five-point spread total in the 11 games they have. With me tonight, George Taylor, Zach Atkinson, I'm Stacey Atkinson bringing you this game. Crowd just filing in. Guys, welcome.
Thank you for the invite, Stacey. I'm really happy to be here, and I can see a great playoff game.
Normal here, guys, with this Mill Rats crowd. They're on their feet. Cowbells are behind us, making tons of noise until the Mill Rats score their first point. Unfortunately, it's been kind of a curse. They've been 2 to 3 minutes in most games at home before they score that first point. So let's see if they any special play tonight. Get them rolling early. And I tell you what, get the ball to Anthony Anderson, and he'll find the right guy. Stover not getting that one to go, but I like the look. Found it down into the big guy right away, and then get that 3-point shot going.
Exactly. Let's work a little inside and maybe outside. Whoa. There's a turnover.
Welcome to all the Moncton fans tuning into this game. St. John Mill Rats fan that couldn't make it to the stadium tonight, still lots of time. Get your butts down here. And welcome to everybody else around North America and around the world watching these young men play. We know we got a lot of NBL fans. We've got a lot of friends and family to these young men playing. So welcome to everybody.
Good defense there.
Yeah, you know, Gennaro, that's a shot he normally makes, but you gotta wonder if the outstretched hands of the league's leading shot blocker is gonna make him miss. Is gonna make him miss as the game goes on. And folks, that 3-point shot we've seen from Mahan off the backboard, that was on purpose. He once in a while from that angle likes to. And Doug Heron Jr. gets one to go. So tough going to the basket. Here we go. Now, if you couldn't hear us before, you can hear us now. The cowbells have quieted down. And but Zach, you can contest to Doug Heron Jr. all year long. So tough when he gets in the paint. Now, so tough.
Here we go again.
Yeah, you get it.
He's so good at body control. He gets in the air.
Well, who do you say he has learned from the most from this team, from his style of play?
Oh, Anthony.
Anthony Anderson, yeah. A lot of things we've seen Doug Heron.
Yeah.
Well, you can't just hold him.
Like that.
His jersey. Yeah, no, you can't do that.
Wow, there. The guys, we're going to see that all game because they know how tough Anthony Anderson is. And to try to keep him in check, you have got to be really physical with him. The team's leading scorer at 21 points a game, Gabe Freeman, gets his first one to go.
Nice. Still, good hands. Up.
Wow, right, you know, hold of his arm. That's a good thing about the three-man system here, guys, is that was blinded out from the lead and the trail official, but the guy on the side said, I saw it.
Oh, it's far better. Officiating with three.
Oh, yeah. Oh, look at Lob Pass. Upstairs.
play on that. It looked like he was pretty still to me, but nonetheless, he's closer than we are. He's got the whistle in his mouth. And
that's a great play for the backdoor screen, though, and maybe we'll see that again. It's a great play.
Gabe says, if I'm going to foul you, you are not making the shot. I can guarantee you. When you've got an easy one and Gabe Freeman's the one fouling you, you're not going to make the shot. You know, it's nothing malicious. It's nothing dirty. It's smart basketball. It's a good hard foul. Good hard foul and puts you to the free throw line.
Yeah, how many times do you see that, you know, an N1 shot like that because you don't... really do a good job on, you know, defense, and if you're going to foul, foul so he doesn't make the shot.
Exactly.
Exactly. So, Stacey, you said that we expect this to be close all the way through.
Well,
it's really starting out that way.
It is. You know, tail of the tape, you look at Anderson back. Percentage, steals, rebounds, assists, right down the line, basically even with these two teams. Points per game, 109. Moncton points per game, 107. You know, and 109 is a league leader. So tail of the tape, very close. Very close. And we've seen all year long, George, every game between these two, except for one game, they've met 11 times already. Millrats have won 8, Moncton have won 3, but all 11 games except for the one game have been within 3 to 5 points.
Well, I certainly agree with you. This is a playoff sort of fever. There's a playoff sort of sense around the arena tonight. And
yeah, definitely. I fully expected this place to be packed tonight. There's still some fans filing in here. But it's a playoff game, but it is a Wednesday night in St. John. A lot of folks just getting home from work probably, and hopefully see them file in here in the next little bit. You know, three times they've gone just over in this game. Quite often don't go to them three times in a quarter or a half. So good sign. Looking to get some scoring out of the big fella early. Along with that, you know, 4 block shots a game. And Johnny Mahane couldn't get it to go. Johnny Mahane, almost 43% from the three-point line this year. Leads the league in three-point percentage.
Nice block.
Tyrell Tate, you know, 4 quick points for Tyrell Tate, just 5 minutes gone in this game, and I tell you what, he had to earn that one. That's something right there I talked to Coach about before the game. Guys getting trapped or aggressive double teams coming, and then guys not making themselves available, and you have to take what looks like, you know, because you're under pressure and you get a 5-second count coming, the first guy that looks even semi-open, and that might be some kind of a lob pass. And at this level, you can't throw lob passes in the half court.
You get picked off or tapped out of, you know, like that, so it breaks up your continuity.
Yeah, right, and those are turnovers that are in killer areas that lead to dunks at the other end of the floor, right? And you know, Coach Bond said, I addressed that, several times during the year.
It's definitely one of the pregame talks, especially with this Moncton team.
Yeah, this Moncton crew, yeah.
So athletic.
Yeah, they want to get out and run.
If you can remember, in those other games, they would have 5 or 6 turnovers on top of that key that were running for dunks. And, you know, Coach Bond talked about that. And offensive rebounding. They've done a great job offensive rebounding.
Yeah. Well, you know,
keeping them off the glass. That's a huge, huge thing that
Vaughn has addressed and has Doug Herring Jr. with a big three. You know, Coach Vaughn has addressed turnovers, especially around that top of the key area that lead to dunk. If you can go back and watch the last five or six games, and I have over the last couple days, very, very few turnovers compared to the first 36 games of the season are happening at the top of the key. Turnovers now are maybe an illegal screen. Once in a while, stepping out of bounds, end line or sideline. Very few passing turnovers now. You look at the start of the year, over half the games to start the season were passing turnovers that led to dunks at the other end of the court. And a lot of it was, like Coach Spahn said, Anthony Anderson gets double teamed, an aggressive double team, and Moncton likes to do that off screen and rolls. They like to throw that aggressive double team, but people think that Anthony Anderson is so good, he doesn't need that help. They've got to get that out of their heads that it can be Chris Paul out there, it doesn't matter. Double team, he needs somebody to pass to. You need to make yourself available. He's addressed that in practices, and you've seen that in the games as of late. They're not turning the ball over anymore.
So does that mean they've made an effort to not go with your east-west pass as much as your north-south pass?
Exactly, and that's what he said also. Let's stop skipping guys at the top of the key. We're not playing against a zone. We're playing against man-to-man every time we play. Why are we skipping that 15-foot pass and throwing the 30-foot pass? Why are we doing that? And you've seen them really clean it up. And like Zach said, they've really cleaned up on the defensive. There was games that were where they've given up 20 offensive rebounds. Not anymore. And all that, George, you know, is, and Zach, you know, is heart. His heart and desire and toughness, mental toughness and physical toughness. Great pass. Freeman couldn't get it to go, but
very unselfish play, though. You know you're going to give it up to your trailing teammate. That's all the trails like that. Get the ball every now and then on the trail. It couldn't work out that way, but
hey, it makes you keep running, right?
Exactly.
Wow, where was we got a foul down low. 12.
Anderson's holding him down.
Yeah, Anderson with the.
He's trying to say straight up.
You know, and guys, once every five games, Anderson says something to the official. He very rarely says anything. So I've got to tend to believe him. You know, these guys that never say anything. You know, I'd have to see a replay, but he's probably got a beef. I guess is the point I'm trying to make. He doesn't complain. He very rarely says something. And
I think we both know several players that whine all the time, and you know, they are not likely to get our nod that they're probably right. They're probably just whining like they always do.
Yeah. And you know, and he's not one of them. So if he's saying something, he's probably. But that might just light a little. That might just put a little fuel to that fire. Because
take it right to the hoop.
If there's a player in the stadium you don't want to get mad, it's Anthony Anderson. We've seen him get a little giddy up in his step when he gets upset, when he gets mad. We've seen about an extra 10 to 15 points come on the scoreboard above his average. And, you know, we seen one night here, George, about a month and a half ago. He was mad at the start of the game about something. It was similar. Maybe it was a bad call. I'm not sure what it was. He ended the game with 53.
Impressive.
Yeah, it was pretty to watch. It was one heck of a. He was. And he still made one. It was some fun to watch.
Well, Zach says he should have had the fries. He said the fries were delicious here, so maybe he should have had the fries.
Yeah.
Well, that's hot off the rim, so they can start their break.
You know, that's a good sign for the Millrats to see James Justice miss a three bad. And Anthony Anderson, here he goes. Yeah, he's almost. great on cue, because whenever you say something about Anderson, he's doing something good soon after you talk about him, because he does something good all the time. Like it's almost on cue every time you say something.
He's got 9 of 18.
And Chris Smith checking into the game for Johnny Mahan. Johnny Mahan getting a rest, lined up a couple threes, couldn't get him to go. So Chris Smith, the younger brother of J.R. Smith that plays for the Cleveland Cavaliers, and you'll see some similarity. If you haven't seen him play before, you'll see some similarity in his game. His same shooting technique, the way he moves, the way he ball handles. He is J.R. Smith's brother. It's not hard to tell. You know what, Chris, a couple stints with the New York Knicks, George.
Is Johnny Mahan one of the players that needs to actually get a couple shots to go down early to get his touch, or
no?
He'll
affect him.
He'll miss six in a row and then
make the next six.
He's
a confident shooter. It's why he's been pushed. It's why I think Coach Vaughn has pushed him into the starting lineup. His stats don't lie. He's 42-43% from three, and he's fearless. You know, which makes you a good shooter, really. You know, Doug says, hey, why not? I've hit a couple.
I'm out.
That's going to block the timeout, I think. I think the Millers have them on the run a little bit here. What do you think?
I think so, but
this is far from over.
Yeah, a 9-point lead at this level. Coach McKesky says, I've seen enough. I've seen enough. Let's talk some things over. Guys are getting open threes. You can tell just, you know, talking to his assistant coaches there now. Guys are getting open threes. Why? What's going on? Why are they left open? It's tough enough. We have tough enough. They make threes with hands in their face. These Coach Bond, George, Zach, he's been here before. He knows what it takes to win a championship. He has won championships. He's won championships in the CBL. He's coached in this league before. He knows what it takes to win. We've seen, like we talked about, he's cleaned up on the turnovers. He has his team cleaned up on the defensive end, on the rebounding. They haven't peaked. They didn't peak until about two games ago, which is a really good sign of a good coach. A good coach, you'll see progression as the season goes on. You'll see them get better each and every time they play. If you don't see them getting better from halfway through the season to the end of the game, he stops. Something has happened with that coach that he is not making that team any better. You don't see that with Coach Vaughn. You see this team get better every single game they play, and they're just peaking now. They're stopping the basketball off the dribble now. They're rebounding the ball at the opposite end of the floor. You see right there, you see the team defense close. You didn't see that at the start of the season. And Chris Smith gets down the court. A 3-on-0 break, guys. A 3-on-0 break.
They're trying to decide who is going to shoot the ball.
You know, that peaking too early, I think, was a real concern of the Golden State Warriors when they started off with such a torrid pace in the NBA. But, you know, the coach coming back, Steve Kerr coming back, I think, you know, changed it up a little bit from Coach Walton. Interim coach, and they really finished strong. And
oh, wow. That's Chris Smith going to his left and getting an offensive foul. Wow, that's just, I think, a good basketball play.
Well, he's a little frustrated, I think, by that call.
Yeah, and I don't blame him. Olu Famutimi getting set to check in the game. Olu has been playing some great basketball. And as the game's going,
Coach Vaughn is very high on him, just defensively. Things he does defensively are...
Yeah.
Almost a shot clock violation, but they managed
threw
to.
Threw it up there, and Martin with the hammer. Throw it down, big man.
Exactly.
Throw it down.
Exactly. I knew that was coming. I hoped it would be for the Mill Rats, but hey, that the big fella did put it down.
Hey, you know what? You know, like I've said in broadcast before, I don't ever want to offend anybody listening, especially the opposing team's fans watching the game. We are Mill Rats broadcasters. We're Mill Rats fans first, but we'll do our best to call this game equal. You know, I'm talking about a couple fouls. I really didn't agree with them. It wasn't because it was against the Mill Rats. If it happened against Moncton, I'd be saying the same thing. If it was a call I didn't agree with, an offensive foul, whatever it was, I'll say it. I don't care whose team it is. I'm more familiar with the Mill Rats players.
Well, first and foremost, we're basketball fans, aren't we? Really.
Exactly.
And seeing this brand of basketball can be really great brand of basketball, and we're going to try to promote it wherever we can, right?
Exactly. Away off the mark.
Well, that was rebounded by a crowd of five Mill Rats right there, so they are really on top of it here today.
You know, I gotta say, you know, I'll say over and over, and there's Doug Herring here. Wow. You know, showing why he's been runner-up in this league a couple different times for the MVP of the league. Mr. Consistent leads his team in assists with just over six assists a game, and in games leads them in scoring. You know, you gotta think. You gotta think Martin's gonna knock those shots down eventually. He's a big guy with a great stroke out there, great extension of the arm, great follow through. About a 35% three-point shooter, but you know, we've seen him in games where he's made none. We've seen him in games where he's made five and six in a row and just killed the Mill Rat. So. Wow. 30 seconds left in the clock, 6 second differential here. You will see the Mill Rats hold as long as they can in this shot clock. Limit Moncton to the last 5 seconds or so. Now I say that and they're giving them over 13 seconds to get a score here. Oh, we got an illegal screen.
I really don't think that's what the coach wanted, probably that early shot, but
no, it wasn't. Oh, lots of time left, lots of time.
Oh, smart.
Wow. What a smart play by Chris Smith. Oh, he's calling sideline, but he put the shot up.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, I think the referees need to get together.
Ooh.
Because if he asked for help, another referee did see. That was a shot attempt. He was in the air, got fouled, heard the whistle, and threw it up to the rim for a shot attempt.
I think he should be rewarded with 3 points, three free throws there.
Yeah, but definitely.
Yeah. That's a tough shot.
Well, Anderson at the buzzer. If there's anybody you want to take a tough shot, it's Anthony Anderson at the end of a quarter. 26-18, first quarter lead. Mill Rats up. But, folks, there could be 30 seconds left in an 8-point game at this level, and the game's not over. We've seen too many things happen with these two teams. And, like I said earlier, Moncton down a couple points, hit a shot from half court for the win. We've seen St. John hit a shot to win. And like I said, 5 points difference the entire season. And that's 11 games, 11 times. This is the 12th meeting for these two teams. So you want to talk about rivalry? You play a team 11 times in a season.
You know, oftentimes that translates into some real animosity out there, you know, because you're facing those same people 11 times. But I don't see that on the court. I see both teams playing hard, which is a compliment for both teams, I think.
Yeah. You know, and you'll see at times, maybe fourth quarter, you'll see some animosity, but I doubt it. It's guys playing hard, and it's guys making basketball plays, doing the right thing. You're right, George. You know, to be who keeps playing good basketball and making basketball plays and just playing hard.
Now will the Millrats on a rebound, defensive rebound, are they trying to push it up every time or really kind of control push to set up their half court?
Millrats are at their best when they're running the ball. Absolutely. We've seen them bury teams from in a 2-3 minute stretch from just.
You remember the Phoenix Suns from 5 or 6 years ago?
Yes.
With who was coaching them, went on to the New York Knicks to coach.
Dan Tony
and so Nash and Sean.
You remember how quick they were shooting the ball on the shot clock? That's Coach Vaughn.
Yeah.
He wants a ton of points. He wants the first good shot you can take. Definitely. So to answer your question, Zach's right. Defensive rebound, he wants to run. He wants to run. You know, why walk it up the floor and now only have 14 seconds left in your shot clock trying to get something? And the defense, all five defenders are back with their feet set playing defense. And here's a...
Volsi.
Ricky Volsi and Famutimi.
Hey, there's a rebound.
And Volsi, the 6'8 fifth. Volsi gets in there for the rebound. Took that rebound from Famutimi. He was going to get two, Zach. I've been on Famutimi sometimes about rebounding the ball more as a guard. And
it was that first offensive board, though, that started everything, didn't it? He didn't get the two-point reward, but he gets the appreciation for the teammate, right?
That's exactly right. You know, and I've said, I've watched him in games where he has a great box out on the defensive end. He's clearing his guy out of the key. He holds his box out so that a teammate can get the rebound. So I said, if I could give you half a rebound every time you did that, you'd be getting your 5 rebounds a game. Well, you see him play more. Our coach Spahn's a smart guy. He's a smart coach, and he sees all these little things that these players do, and as well as the big things.
Wow! There's a touch.
Got the rule. Hey, there's, and he said, you know, I was hit on that too. I should be going to the line, but when we say shooter touch, George, we mean. Guys have great spin on that basketball. They have a great extension of the arm. They have the perfect arc, perfect spin on the ball. So when that ball, for all you young kids out there, you hear all your basketball life, you need more spin on the basketball, you need more spin. But you never really know why you need more spin. You need more spin because Famutimi on fire, like we've seen him do before.
You know, it just does so much good when the ball bounces around the rim. You make an offensive rebound opportunity, you definitely will get a long bounce out right for a fast break for the other team. But if your shot's too flat, bounces off hard,
right.
the defense keeps it down and turn that into offensive points.
Yeah, Famutimi,
that was 10 quick points.
He's on a roll.
Wow. Well, they got him for seven.
So that's 10. That's one of his.
No, I think one of his threes must have been stepped on the line. Yeah, he's got two threes and a. I thought two threes and a two, but one of those threes must be a two.
So with your tail of the tape, Stacy, you're talking about when you made up some stats. Do they get more shot attempts than their opposition most games because of their
the Millrats do. They lead the league in scoring. They lead the league in shot attempts. They lead the league in 3-point shot attempts. So yeah. Yeah, they get out more shot attempts because they get out in front everything. Hey, I mean, it makes sense, right? I mean, Coach Bond, what he's doing is that if we get more shot attempts than them, good shot attempts, we have a chance to score more points. So how do you win a basketball game?
Usually score more points.
More points, exactly. Yeah, I'm still waiting for... brain cramp here.
I was going to say rebounds never win a game because they will use that often. Oh, the team that rebounds is going to win the game. It's ultimately points that win the game, right?
It's ultimately points. You know, I threw that rebound thing out the window, George, when I watched the Golden State Warriors win a game by 20. They were out-rebounded 65-42. So that rebounding thing just went out the window for me. So.
A team like that shoots an incredibly high percentage.
And a lot of those are threes. Yeah. Yeah.
So I agree with you. It you know, it's one of the stats to look at, but it's not certainly the stat. And you were talking to me earlier before the game started about Anthony Stover being such a good shot blocker. And that must start some of the fast breaks too, right?
Oh, definitely.
Oh, he's one of the best at outletting that basketball and starting the breaks. He's over, you know, some games throwing some beautiful passes, outlet passes that have led straight to layups.
I'm still waiting to see some of that prowess. I haven't noticed, too much yet, his shot blocking capability, but I'm anxious to see it.
Yeah, you'll see it. Anthony usually starts the game, plays six to 7 minutes. There's a second crew that comes in that is very, very guard defending oriented. That changes the game and gets out. They get out and run like you see them doing now. Doug Herring Jr. almost gets that to go. That would have been the toughest shot I've seen all year if he got that one to go
over the rim.
Yeah, and then you'll
just
see
great basketball smarts to still be able to get a hand on that ball and know where to go.
Wow, great pass. The 6'8" Ricky Bursey up top with that high shooting pocket. He also passes out of that high shooting pocket. And so many times we see 6'8" down low to a score. And the Millrats here, guys, just firing on all cylinders right now.
Ty Beatty, strong take.
You know, I said all year, you can be pretty equal with the Millrats, but when they're knocking threes down, they are one top team. They are the toughest team in the NBL to beat.
We've seen them put up, 140-some points in that?
140-some points, yeah. 135
points. Anderson gets his foul in the three-point attempt from the corner there this time, so let's see what happens.
Hey. Well, free throws. It's been...
Missed a couple free throws here early for the Millrats, but... two in a row from Anderson. That hasn't happened since he was grade five, probably.
No, has been a knock on them all year, though.
Well, you say that, and they lead the league in free throw percentage at 80%.
Well, they probably lead the league at getting to the line.
No, they lead the league at 80% as a team.
But you just jinx our man.
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know.
But, Zach will contest. We've seen a lot of games this year where the Millrats have shot something like 10 for 22 from the free throw line.
Yeah. Try it again. Team has five in a row. That's four.
Oh, no, they're going to get the
big man. I don't think I've ever missed four in a row.
They're going to get the
big
man.
Yeah, you have.
Three in a row. Maybe they can go on and miss another three in a row.
The big man cannot bring his hands down.
They're
going to be a foul every time. Keep your hands up. Keep your feet planted. You're going to not draw that foul, but this time.
But, Anthony Anderson, if he's not fouled there, he makes the basket. Nobody knows that better than the big guys in this league. Buster Granato, he's so good at drawing contact. Keeping you flat-footed, per se, and then knocking a shot down.
Well, goodness knows, Granato was a big man
about that call.
Big man.
Yeah, Granato's 6'10". They got him at 225. That's not right, is it, George?
No.
He's more around the 255, 265 mark.
Yeah.
I think it's a misprint tonight at 225. I'm pretty sure I've seen him in the books before at around 265.
That is a stat sheet from when he was in ninth grade.
I think so, yeah. And the guards here for, like I said, Stover plays 6-7 minutes. They bring in a really guard-strong lineup that can really defend and stop the ball. A different defense. Stover is, I'm going to block your shots, change your shots. So the interior defense is incredible. To a group of guards like this that can flat out score the ball from the three-point line and get out and run. You'll see these guards before long get a rest. You'll see Stover come back in the game and the defense changes to the interior presence again. And Famutimi say, hey, you're going to take my shot away? I'm going to get to the rim. shows that athleticism. He is athletic.
Miller, I was trying to make a statement early in this series.
Zach, let's get back to your foul shooting. I think that as a fellow men's leaguer, 260, that's a little bit more like it, isn't it? Sometimes we can string a few misses together, can't we?
We can, yes.
Yeah, they are not afraid of the three-point shot, are they?
They are not.
They embrace it.
Mostly back in this game.
Yeah, folks, we're just clearing up the 225 for Thomas Granato. He's in the real stats at 260. That's more like it. He's a big guy. Martin steps out to three. You've got to think he's going to knock him down eventually. Anthony Anderson back in the game. Didn't get that rebound, but tipped it to a teammate. And they start to run. Like you asked, George, do they get out and run on a defensive rebound?
Yes, they do. No doubt about that.
And, like, you know, I say firing on all cylinders. If this is a 12-cylinder car, they're firing on 11 of them right now.
What a Stover challenge, actually.
Oh, yes. 6'11", challenging 5'8", shooting the three. You don't see Justice shooting too many air balls, do you, Zach?
No.
And folks, pay no attention to this score, 47-24.
No, this Moncton team can put some points on the board in a hurry as well.
They can go on a 10-0 run and be back in this game in a heartbeat. Wow, and Johnny Mahan, you know, usually when you see him make one like he just did a minute ago, he's going to fire another one in a hurry. He only needs to make one to throw up a heat check.
Pretty move.
Yeah, Martin says, hey, I'm not locking it down from three. I'm going to get to the lane. You know, he's a big guy. You got him at 6'8", but
Wow.
50 points. With 5 minutes to go in the second quarter, I say all cylinders, they are firing on all cylinders.
So for anyone out there that likes the offensive side of the game, they're loving this.
Yeah, definitely. You know, just over and over, the only shot blocker in the league plays for the Millrats. So what the Millrats have done, like you've noticed, they love firing that three. They have some great three-point shooters, but they have found other ways to score, like getting to the rim. Stover wants that ball inside.
Good look for the big man inside. Good.
Yeah,
yes,
yeah,
he did. He shot it.
You know, you never want to fake or pump fake and straighten your legs. Keep your knees bent. You can't travel when your knees are bent. It's almost impossible. Go on the floor, grab the basketball, try to travel with your knees bent in an athletic stance. It's tough. They're still over with the block.
Very nice.
He's here. I'll give it back. I'll block another one.
He got a piece of that. He got a piece of that.
Then he says, give me that ball. This guy's...
I'll pass that one.
Yeah, I'm going to pass that out.
Oh, yeah.
The offensive foul. What a defensive set for Anthony Stover.
Can I block the shot?
And an offensive foul.
He is getting support from his teammates on that one.
Oh, yeah.
That was a great stand there.
Wow. And everyone,
Everyone in this gym, including me, thought he was jumping at that.
Wow. Gabe Freeman into the game for Olu Famutimi, and what a hand from his teammates and from this crowd for Famutimi.
And I've got him for 4 rebounds right now, too.
Wow.
Famutimi.
He is having the best game in a Millrass uniform. Wow, Doug not getting that one to go. Top shot.
Stover changed that one. Hey, it was going in.
He said, "Hey, it was going in. Even if I do that, it might make you miss the next one." Now, I was just talking a few minutes ago with Stover out of the game. Spong was real guard strong. That's a real defensive unit, and can score from the three. It put a lot of pressure on the guards, and now you see a different unit come in, and you see them really strong in the interior with Stover shot blocking. And
Justice with a bucket.
I think that plan does make it really tough on the defense, because you're getting a different look regularly.
It's almost like going, full court man-to-man back to a half court, or back down to a 2-3 zone, to a 1-3-1 zone, or, you're changing your lineup like that. It changes where you're really strong defensively.
Coach Strawn not liking the last couple offensive possessions. Going to call a timeout.
Hey, that's,
Well, I don't blame him, do you?
Absolutely not. They weren't very great. No, turnover and a brick. I don't care. He says, though, I don't care. We're up 22 points right now. You're not playing how I want you to play.
Exactly. Yeah, that's one of the good things about Coach Bond. He is not going to be happy. I'm not even going to say when the buzzer goes off at the end of the game and they win. He's not going to be happy until the buzzer goes off and they won a championship. That's when he'll be happy.
And that's part of the reason his team responds to him so well.
I kind of like this music, Stacey. I don't know, can we dance or something? Is that loud?
If the dance cam gets on you, George, I want you to stand up on your stool and you go right to town.
Go for it.
You know, I know you want a big shout out to your son here tonight. I'll let you do that. Oh. He's in Indianapolis watching this game, so you go ahead and say a big shout out
to
him.
Well, you hear it. Yeah, I want to say hello to my son, Chris Taylor. He could be on his way to Louisville. I don't know. They're going to go down to the Cuckin Derby this weekend. So, but I think he's rolling in Indy watching the game, and I do want to send my love to him and my beautiful wife, Regina. She must be listening in Calais, too, you suppose.
Yeah. And tell us a little about your son, George. George is from Calais, Maine. Brought his son up in Calais, Maine. Tell us a little bit about what your son's doing in Indianapolis.
Chris was fortunate to have a really good high school basketball career in Calais, and was part of a 2-time state championship Blue Devil team. And then when he finished high school, he went off to college and really enjoyed his time in Boston at Emerson College. Got an opportunity to work for the Celtics, and they went through their championship run in 08. Got a chance to be part of that, so he was really happy. And he's always been a huge Kevin Garnett fan, and when Kevin came to the Celtics, it just was made everything complete, really. And, he made some connections and befriended the strength and conditioning coach of the Indiana Pacers, who was originally from Maine as well. And one thing led to another, and Chris was fortunate enough to be granted an NBA internship with the Pacers. I can back up a little bit. He spent 1 year as an intern with the Maine Red Claws, the Developmental League team in Portland, Maine, and then went off the Indiana Pacers And fortunately, they liked what he did, and they brought him on full time, and he enjoys himself in the front office for the Pacers.
Yeah.
He's working primarily right now with the scouts, domestic and international. They've got quite a good good group. I won't say it's led by Pat Knight, but Bobby Knight's son that had coached at Texas Tech and now is an NBA scout for the Pacers. And Matt Doherty, who had been a University of North Carolina player, coach at UNC, and is also a scout for the Pacers. And he works with those fellows closely. And of course, I don't know if you've heard of his boss. Maybe Larry Bird.
Larry Bird.
There it is.
Yeah, his office is right across the hall from Chris's. That's tough to take. Yeah, I remember going in. We were there a couple years ago, George and I and our wives. And, you know, of course, we get into a couple Pacer games. We're touring the facility. And Chris takes me down to his office and said, oh, yeah, that office across the hall there, that's Larry Bird's office. I was like, that's hard to take. How do you come to work every day?
It's been real enjoyable, and I know he, along with a lot of loyal Indiana fans, were sad that Toronto knocked them out of the playoffs. But you know, number two, they deserve to be number two. They beat a number seven seed, which you know, is not unusual.
Took them to game seven.
Game seven. And Chris Christian was very encouraged that Paul George made such a comeback after really a devastating, potentially career-ending injury.
Oh, it broke his leg in half.
They said, yeah.
You know, comes back not only playing, but playing at the level he's playing at. So, so Christopher, a big hello from Zach and I here. Glad to have your dad joining us in the broadcast here with the Millrats. Playoff game against the Moncton Miracles, and Millrats playing some great basketball here tonight.
Exceptional. So I'm just happy to be here. You know, I've enjoyed seeing several Millrats games over the years, and Stacy and Friday all came together, and I was able to come with you. I really appreciate the invite.
Yeah, oh, great to have you, buddy.
You know, I don't think when we talk about Indiana, Stacy, Allison, his wife, Regina, and I visited some sites, and you know, when they did the pregame of the Hickory team getting the warm up for the, you know, the talk from the coach Gene Hackman. We were in that facility.
We were in that locker room.
In that locker room.
Yeah.
We shot some baskets in the old Hickory gym.
Yeah, yeah. So. That's the start of every game, the Millrats play that little clip from the movie Hoosiers with Gene Hackman. And I say to whoever's around me, I was there. I was in that locker room. I shot baskets in that gym. It was, you know, where they filmed most of the, you know, the home games for the movie Hoosiers. And
yes,
it was surreal, George. It was quite amazing, really. You know,
of course, that's the major motion picture. I think the best sports movie of all time, personally.
I do too. Yeah.
And it was all about Little Milan High School back in the day, winning the Indiana State Championship. Over, you know, much larger teams. Possibly Crispus Attucks High School, a big urban school. And that still is legend, of course, in Indiana.
Yeah.
And really the world now.
Yeah. Yeah, and what a lot of people don't know, even some people in Indiana don't know, that, you know, the gym they filmed that, you know, the home games and stuff in for the movie Hoosiers was in a little town called Knightstown.
Yes.
Knightstown. It wasn't in Milan. It was in a little town called Knightstown, and now is a rec center run by an older fella that were super, super nice. He toured us around, and when we were there, there were people from the town walking around the gym, getting some exercise and whatnot. And he said the local kids after school will come into the gym. They flock to that gym. It closes at 5, and they get there and play basketball, nonstop.
You know, we're so proud in Maine to have Christopher's, the team he was on a couple times, win the state championship. And basketball's big in Maine, right? Would you agree?
Oh, definitely.
But, boy, we went out, he and I, to see a Indiana State High School championship game, and that was something. They fill the Bankers Life Fieldhouse. 20,000 seats are filled with four different high school teams, their supporters. It's really amazing.
Wow, yeah.
So it's just on a different level, you know, but...
Okay. Hey, folks, we're talking here. Back to the game. 59-37 at the half. Anthony Anderson couldn't get one to go, but you've seen a couple more threes knocked down by the Mill Rats while we were talking. Just like I said, firing on all cylinders tonight. We will get you some halftime stats here. Probably about 2 minutes to go in this half, so come back in about St. John at 50, just over 52%. At only 36% from the floor for Moncton. So, like I said, 0 for 15 from the three-point line for Moncton. That's the basketball game. That's the 22-point lead you see here with 10 for 20 from the three-point line for St. John.
Well, not to hop on these free throws for Anthony Anderson, but, you know, you mentioned his average is 17. He's got 10, right, 7 free throws, and he makes them all. He's at his average in the first half.
Yeah, he's at his average, yeah.
But that wasn't meant to be, wasn't to be, so.
Yeah, Martin gets a basket to go and gets a free throw. So just like that, first three points, Moncton, 19-point lead here for the Mill Rats. You know, Coach Spahn's telling these guys, don't change a thing. Don't change the pace. You know, we don't change the pace up 19 or 22, whatever it was, until there's a few minutes to go in the game. We don't change the pace and let them dictate the tempo or, you know, the pace of the game.
My experience, that's a sure way to lose the game when you start changing, when you start playing it safe, right, and you don't go into your regular pattern of offense. We don't want this team to slow it down. We want to keep moving. The coach wants to keep moving.
Yeah, definitely. You know, keep doing the things you've been doing. So, you know, a basket and a free throw for Anderson. So back to a 22-point lead. And, folks, don't think this game is over with a 22-point lead because
there's a block.
There's another block, Stover.
Good hands by Mahan.
22 points in this league can go away in a 2 or 3 minute stretch here. Yeah, a little, you know, it's a question on who hit that out. The referees got together like they should. And, yeah, I saw it the same way you did, out of bounds, Moncton, St. John basketball.
Very nice.
How many 5'10 guys, George, have you seen in your life consistently go in the paint against 6'9", 6'10", and not get a shot blocked? Not only not get a shot block, but
Stover with a piece of that one.
Oh, that was Freeman that went after that one.
Well, probably the most fearless player I can remember right now is Allen Iverson, right? That just would consistently take it to the paint against the big bodies and pay the price many times.
Yeah, you know, take it right to the chest of a shot blocker, make him go flat-footed, and get himself to the line. Yeah, how many times you see Allen Iverson laying on the floor? As many times as Dwayne Wade, Zach?
No. Dwayne Wade just a little better finisher.
Yeah, I guess
Dwayne Wade's bigger and stronger. That's why you don't.
Well, it amazes me with Dwayne Wade. For a man of his agility and athleticism and strength, how many times he gets knocked to the floor?
Yeah.
He just contorts that body almost parallel to the floor sometimes just to get a shot off.
Yep.
And does, but you know, that body has paid the price over the years.
Yes, so it has.
Hitting that hardwood floor from, you know, 6 feet in the air.
Again, when you look at those bodies, like we have here, you don't appreciate the size of some of these men playing basketball, right? Yep. But Dwayne Wade's a legit 6'4".
Yeah.
You said a big body. And with his athleticism, but he does go down. He goes down hard sometimes.
He does, yeah, definitely does. You know, and guys, we brought a friend here with us tonight, Steve McGinley, and he's sitting here in the broadcast booth with us. It's his first NBL game. He hasn't been to one yet. I asked him at halftime, "What do you think?" And his eyes wide open. And he's just, I can't believe the speed. I can't, the skill and the strength of these
players. It will not be his last.
No, it won't be his last. No. Wow, great pass from Freeman to Stover.
Really keep it high.
Yeah, catch it high, keep it high, shoot it high. It's what you teach your kids, right? And Stover, a true big man, and he does.
Oh.
You got to think he does. But George, we've seen James Justice many, many games make that shot.
Yes.
Stover doesn't bother him most times. He is a tough little nut. Freeman picked up another foul, and Martin to the line.
Three on
Gabe Freeman. I believe what the folks are seeing at home is now showing the foul count. We had our social media guy here, Ryer. Okay, yeah, he confirmed. I mean, you guys know you're at home listening to this game, but we just wanted to find out. We have a monitor here, but all we see is a game. We don't have the score. We look at the scoreboard above us, and foul count. So it used to be we try to give you an update on any foul trouble, anything like that, but you can see it there now.
Tough shot.
Yeah, not a great shot from Freeman. Still in about 5-6 seconds on the shot clock, but I think trying to draw the foul there more than anything.
Spawn a little. Words.
You know, what I'd like to see out of these plays, if you can see at the bottom of your screen there, Ricky Bolsey comes off the bench, pulls Gabe Freeman over to the sideline, and, you know, has a few words, and, you know, as a veteran on this team, and you see Freeman do the same thing when he's on the bench, sometimes orchestrating the defense and running up and down sideline.
And they're not talking about where they're going to dinner tonight either. They're talking basketball.
Yeah.
So I'm with you on the play and everything there.
Yeah, yeah, maybe.
Although, speaking of dinner, where are we going?
I don't know.
Montana's,
there you go. Well, sure, I'm up for that.
Yeah, there's James Justice right on cue. You know, the league-leading John Blocker coming at him hard. Gets that one to go off the window.
Ooh. I'm not sure if Montana's is open after the game.
And there goes the microphone.
Hey, I tell you what, we talked about this earlier.
Yeah.
He can put some points on the board and bring Moncton back in this game.
He can put points on the board in a hurry. And folks at home, if you don't remember Vinnie Johnson for the Pistons,
nice little backdoor look.
They called him the microwave. The microwave because he comes off the bench, he heats up in a hurry.
Heats up fast.
Puts a ton of points on
and
the board.
And here he comes. By great pass.
Hey, he doesn't make the basket all in. Zach, you talked earlier about Stover's outlet pass.
Heard it, yeah.
You know, that was no sooner in Stover's hands.
One pass on.
Yeah, and that was to the outlet just as quick as that. Textbook fast break.
Rutgers
fast break is what it was, yeah. Ball outlet it on this side of the floor, down the floor to the other side for the layup. Never touching the floor with the dribble.
Donato showing the touch.
The big man has a touch from the corner.
Wow, if Anthony just knew if he rolled to the rim there instead of pop, he had that alley-oop. But hey, gets to the rim, front of the rim that time, gets the ball and gets himself to the free throw line. I'm going to go a little reverse curse here, George. He's going to miss both of them.
It may work. I'd try it.
I just got to shut up when they're shooting free throws. Mama Stover, sorry. I apologize.
We apologize for that.
Hey, one for two.
We'll take it.
Hey, it must have worked. He's a 40% free throw shooter. No, I take that back. He's higher than that.
Now, does he typically don the pink?
Oh, okay. Goodness.
Oh, my goodness. That was the best missed dunk I've ever seen.
There's a big man typically donning the pink shoes. Are they in support of something?
Those are his.
Okay.
Size 16.
Granado. The big fella stepping out and knocking a three down. Hey,
James.
Their first 3-point
shot.
Jeff
is holding his wrist on that one. He'd think that.
And Moncton's first 3-point make from Thomas Granado.
And it's from the big man. Returns
Man's
it. Freeman.
Down. Man down.
Moncton trying to make a push at this.
You know, Gabe having a tough shooting night, tough scoring night here for them. He leads in the scoring with 21, but only 3 points tonight here for him.
But he's still such a difference maker.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, the tips, deflections, the rebounds, the defense. And other guys are stepping up tonight scoring and has taken some of the pressure or some of the load off of him tonight.
Got to get forward in that shot. It was a nice shot. I don't know. I didn't really see the contact. Did you, Zach? I didn't.
It may have been him on the wrist. That's what he's trying to say, but didn't look like it to me. And that cuts it to 15.
Well, we just got a note that
15 with the ball going back to Moncton.
Just got a note that Zach, your mic and George, your mic at times is a bit of an echo. Sometimes if you're holding that too close to your mouth, you'll get a bit of an echo. So we just gotta.
Does it sound better when you hear me twice? Probably not.
Say it again.
For you, George, yes.
Yeah, so folks at home, as you notice, you're watching this, you're watching the game, it's not on the radio, we're not going to give you a play-by-play, who passes to so-and-so, who rebounds, who shot the ball. I mean, you can see all that. So we're talking basketball. We're talking basketball plays. We're talking about plays that are going on during the game. And whether it's a good play, bad play, whether it's from the Millrats, whether it's from Moncton, we're talking basketball. And like George said before the game, we're like Mark Jackson and Jeff Van Gundy and
wannabes.
Yeah.
And we talked about Moncton coming back, making a run. They're coming back out of this timeout, shooting two free throws. Chance to cut it to 13. It's not over.
No, it's definitely not over. I said, folks at home, if you think this is over because it's 22 points, that lead can dissipate in a hurry.
You know, I'd like to welcome everyone that is listening, watching, you know, on some kind of media, to visit the stadium, though, right? We've got a smaller crowd than maybe you anticipated, and we'd like to see more bodies in the stands, too, right?
Well, yeah. Last home game, Saturday night, I don't know exact numbers, but it was somewhere around 3,300 in the stands. But it was a Saturday night, a good night that you know, no school in the morning, you can get your kids out to the game, whatever. This is a Wednesday night game. But it's
the playoffs.
But it's the playoffs. Yeah,
about playoffs.
We're kind of disappointed. Kind of disappointed in the numbers here tonight.
What we want to tell people is it looks like there's plenty of opportunity in the future to come in and get a great seat, right? The people that are here are enthusiastic.
Another game tomorrow night.
Yeah, definitely. You don't have to order your tickets online. You can get them right at the box office and sit pretty much anywhere you want.
I don't know about you, Stacy, but I especially like the cowbell.
Yeah, the cowbell directly.
I hate it.
10 feet behind us.
I hate it.
Yeah, right in my ear. Yeah.
Yeah,
no.
love that. The cowbell, the dinner bell, 10 feet behind us.
I hate it playing. I hate it watching.
And just like that, 13 points. Moncton
doing this, struggling from behind that three-point line.
Well, Moncton knocking down shots now, not from three, but from two. One from Granado inside. And Millrats Milrad's not. You know, not knocking that three down. That's a shot clock violation before the possession. I don't know why the whistle wasn't blown, but.
Now, you know I'm not the coach, obviously, but I think some of the energy from Famutimi would come in handy right now.
Well,
for
you know,
Milrad's, don't you think?
Well, you've got Chris Smith coming in the game, who provided energy in the first half, and I'm sure you're right, George. You'll see Famutimi coming in before long. You know, Coach Vaughn knew what worked in the first half. You know, what got him that lead as far as energy and et cetera. And those guys won't be long. He'll have 13 points, a couple free throws here for Terrell Tate. Can cut this to 11. You know, big momentum swing when it gets down to single digits. So the Milrats are going to do fight tooth and nail here to keep that in that double digit mark. Okay, they've made a run. Let's weather the storm and get that lead back. A big shout out, guys, to one of Zach and I's partners in crime all season long, Chris Woodside, who has been broadcasting most of the games this season, hasn't been with us the last couple weeks, but back with us in the broadcast booth tomorrow night. Chris, a big hello to you. I know you're watching the game at home. And just like that, up there with Anthony Stover. Throw it down, big man, right? Throw
it down. That gets him going.
Yeah, so Chris, looking forward to having you back in their broadcast booth with tomorrow night. George had some big, and so we got a piece of that. Big shoes to fill, but doing a great job here in the broadcast booth with us tonight.
Chris is a very nice young man, a wonderful representative of the game of basketball, and I'm sure he just does a wonderful job.
Yeah, he does. Right on cue.
I hope you enjoy the order.
Throws one down, goes down the floor, gets a blocked shot. Gets a big hand from this crowd as he leaves the floor. And George Famutimi in the game. Chris Smith in the game.
Well, I wonder, is Coach picking up our feed? You know, do you think he just I don't know.
You know what? Well, we're some great basketball minds sitting here in this broadcast booth. And
telepathically, he knows.
You just could tell.
Anderson! Knocked out.
And that is down time.
He took a step backwards and he was in the center circle at half court. Wow.
That might have been from Sussex. I don't know. It was way downtown. I don't know.
Now that's the opposite way.
Well,
that's the opposite way. That's St. George, Benfield area.
Yeah, just the opposite way.
Yeah.
Towards Moncton.
Towards Moncton.
Who says I'm not well versed on Canadian geography?
I know what you're getting at though, because they're playing Moncton.
They're playing.
They go to Moncton and play Thursday for game three.
That's going
to
be on the board.
I mean, if they're playing St. Stephen, I definitely would have said that.
Yeah.
Oh, great defense. Great. You're seeing guys get their bodies in front of the basketball there now for the Milrats. You didn't see that early in the season. You force a contested jump shot and you box out, period. The game is easy when you play it right.
Chris Smith was definitely moving his feet on defense. Playing great defense, right?
Yeah, Chris Smith, Anderson that last possession. Famutimi, you've seen whoever was guarding the basketball was getting their body in front of the ball and stopping the ball from getting to the paint. Hey, you've got to pass the ball. That guy tries to get to the paint. He doesn't get to the paint. You've got a jump shot that's contested. You get the rebound and you run the floor like you're seeing the Milrats do here.
How about the respond from the Milrats out of that timeout? Pushing this back to 20.
Back to 20. I expect nothing less from Coach Spahn than for his team to execute after a timeout.
Well, that was a good try in the backcourt, but that just winds up to be a foul. That's too bad. Not quite moving the feet.
A lot of the time you hear coaches say, well, it's a backcourt foul. He's 96 feet away from the basket. That's a stupid foul. I like players being aggressive.
It's a stupid foul if it's your big guy.
Well, I like the aggressiveness.
Off a rebound.
in the backcourt. I love, aggressive double teams and traps and don't let the guy go from point A to point B as quick as he wants or easily as he wants.
Yeah, you're inviting those fouls, playing up like that. We'll see.
There's, we talked about before the game, George, 6'8", with a high pocket.
Wow. Is he in the circle?
Don't think he's going to get that.
Wow. He was standing there. For so long, I think he even checked his wrist to see what time it was. He was standing there so long, and he gets the block.
Frustrating play, but...
Wow. It just seems, Ricky Bolsey seems to get a couple of those every game. I feel bad for him. Sometimes he stands there, draws the offensive foul or tries. Now Granato stays with it and gets the... Gets a little reverse layup to go. 82-63. Bat Milrath pushed that back to 21, down to 19 again. And like we said, this Moncton team can go on a run, and they can go on a run in a hurry. And we've seen that got down to 11 here just not too long ago. And like that, a couple baskets in a row, and wow, that's a quick crossover dribble, guys. And a no-look pass to Famutini. Couldn't get the three-point shot to go. Oh, and Doug Herring Jr. To Famutini, who throws it down with two hands. Throws that athleticism, guys. And I was talking about before the game, he is athletic as heck.
Right. Now, on offense, it's all about the spacing. Zach. It's all about the spacing. Was not clogged on that side. Had plenty of room to go to the basket.
All about the spacing,
That's what I think.
Yeah.
I was wondering when that was coming out.
You see the replay there.
I didn't want to let it go in the first half, so I saved it.
Yeah.
All about this basing. Talk about Famutini's athleticism. Did a little bio on Famutini today. The ins and outs, where he played college ball, et cetera, et cetera. But I dug a little deeper in his playing career. And at one time, when he was a senior in high school, he was ranked by ESPN as the eighth best player coming out of high school.
Seventh, wasn't it?
Seventh best player coming out of high school. Very highly recruited. I know there was a really bad knee injury somewhere along the line that hurt him, but he has had. He has had signings with the 76ers. Angle Wave just before the season started. He signed with the San Antonio Spurs back in 06. Just coming off a championship run.
Yep.
And was waived a couple weeks later, just before the season started. And didn't quite make that roster, but that was a tough roster to make.
Yeah.
With, Ginobili and Parker.
They would have lost in the... Western semis, I think, 2006, within that year, to Dallas.
But, just goes to show you, he's definitely got the body, he's definitely got the size, the athleticism, the strength, and no question on the skill. We see him ball handling at some times and knocking those shots down like he does. Any team would be proud at times to have him on the floor in an NBA game,
Yes, absolutely.
You're seeing young Ryan Smith played at UMB Fredericton on the floor for Moncton. And Doug Herring Jr. gets a nifty little reverse to go. Ryan Smith, the friend we brought with us here, Steve, he's watched many UMB games. He's remember seeing Ryan play at UMB. He's a tough player. We've seen him play, log a lot of minutes, a couple different games here for months. He did a fine job with him. Yeah, Ricky Bolsey's like, what are you guys calling here?
Ricky Bolsey.
scored his number three on Ricky. I think all three here in the last 4 minutes of the game. But. Tydrayan Beatty with the old-fashioned 3-9 points for Beatty.
Finish.
He knew the whistle was going before it went. Like, he felt that contact, was confident he was getting fouled.
Meyer basketball play.
You know, had a wide open guy on three. I saw him kind of look at him and I know I'm getting fouled. I'm shooting this basketball. He gets the old fashioned three to go. Good defense, no rats. Good help defense. Good close on Ricky Volsey, and just like that, Cordell Genty with the intentional foul on Ricky Volsey.
He saw his foul. He knew it.
So that's an unsportsmanlike. That will be one shot plus the basketball.
Get that coach back.
Get some words for Coach McKeskey from the fans, not liking him sitting on the scorer's table. Just like we called earlier, guys, down to 11 for Moncton. We see that
great pass,
offensive foul. Ooh. We see that little switch, a few subs come in, very guard, strong defending, and that can really get out, run, knock three down, and all of a sudden back to 25 point lead here for the Millrats. And I'm not sure what happened here with James Justice. He comes in, he a couple quick baskets, he's responsible for a couple more, and then all of a sudden, bang, he's on the bench for the last 5 minutes.
Yeah, he's definitely been the one to get this Moncton team going.
And we get a blocking call it is, yes, Ryan Smith. What he did do was break up the semi-fast break and the transition three-point shot, so not putting Chris Smith to the line. They are in the bonus. And folks at home, if you're looking at this young man on the free throw line and saying, geez, he shoots that ball exactly like J.R. Smith for the Cleveland Cavaliers.
There's a reason for that.
There's a reason for that. It's his younger brother. Wow, great move.
Great move.
Wow.
Nice athleticism there.
That spin towards the paint was quicker than I can run forward without spinning. Face and cheeks. I don't think it's a nephew, but a cousin, George, to Maurice Cheeks in the NBA.
Oh, really?
Yes. Yeah, in the restricted area. Got to call him for the block. Yeah, he's standing there straight up, but in the restricted area, block, Famutini. Two shots at the line for Cordell Genty. You gotta like Cordell, guys. He's as tough as board nails. Knows how to play the basketball game. You know, do what you have to do defensively, offensively to win the game. You know, you talk to him talked to him before the game. You know, you see him conversing with Millrats players and with his own team. Just a nice guy. Nice guy to talk to. Always got a hello for you, handshake for you if you want it. And you know, I can say the same for all these Moncton players, or all these Millrats players, any team that's ever come into this arena. You know, because I'm always here plenty early in the broadcast. And, you know, you can walk up to any of these players, any of these young men, and talk to them and, you know, have a conversation with them. So it says a lot for them, for their organization, and for this league, you know. Always thankful to all their fans.
I'm just thinking they probably really appreciate how St. John has opened their arms to them, welcomed them in, and become really part of the community.
Oh, definitely. You know, very knowledgeable fans in this St. John area, like I've said before, and you know, promote of these games, and you can hear even a lot of comments you hear from the crowd. You know, they know their basketball, and they appreciate how hard this team works, and the diving on the floor, and the diving out of bounds, the physical defense, and et cetera, et cetera. And really, really appreciate it here, and the players know it. These guys know we know what we have to do to get them to appreciate us. You know, it's kind of like that New York crowd, right? You're not performing, they're going to boo you. You're playing well, they're going to scream and holler and ring their cowbells.
I was at Madison Square Garden a few years ago watching the New York Knicks play, and they were still mired in a miserable, you know, just a losing streak, right? Year after year. Isaiah Thomas was a coach at that point. And we were sitting at great seats, they were sitting watching them get beat yet again. And this really nice grandmotherly type person next to me stood up at the intermission and yelled expletives at Isaiah Thomas for like 5 straight minutes. And I said, wow, you know, she's got a point there. But I never thought she would be using that kind of language. But she was a true New York fan, which I knew. You know about this New York fan.
Well, you know, I was at the time we were in Indianapolis. I was sitting, you know, like 10, 12 rows behind the base of bench, and there's a lady, I don't know, she must have been 80 years old, and they said she's had season tickets forever, and I was sitting in those same seats, and she has like 4 or 5 seats. She's always bringing grandchildren, whatever, to the game, and you talk about knowledgeable of the basketball game, and when, big three for Patterson. She was the hardest person I ever seen on Roy Hibbert. When he didn't block a shot or he didn't get a rebound, she was screaming from the stands, and it wasn't nice. And like I said, Famutimi's athleticism, hey, run the floor like a deer, jump like a deer, and throw that thing down. Doug Heron gets it to go, and you know, this crew on the floor, a little small ball here, George. Go small, run the floor, be quick.
Do we know a team in the NBA that does this to quite almost perfection?
I think the Lakers.
Now, do the Lakers do anything with
this? Yeah, the Lakers haven't done anything. I'm a Laker fan, too, but your Golden State Warriors, and you know, and a lot of coaches. You know, you watch the Warriors, hey, small ball does work. Trying to emulate that, but they don't have a Draymond Green, right? So it's hard for other teams in the NBA to go small and match up with them, because they don't have that 6'7", 6'8" guy that can guard the 7'4", 1 center, but also can run the floor and shoot three.
You know, even when you're talking Steph Curry, I wonder if some of the younger players coming up are going to be trying to emulate that, where he doesn't necessarily square his feet. He doesn't necessarily get set in that nice, triple threat position when the ball goes up. I don't know. I mean, it certainly works for him, but I wonder how it's going to work for younger players coming up through. Because goodness knows, all the young people want to emulate the stars, right?
Definitely. You know, I did when I was in high school, middle school, you know, see Michael Jordan do something, see Magic Johnson do something, and then get up, go out in the yard and practice it until I could do it. You know, you're definitely right. They definitely try to emulate the superstars in the NBA. You know, Steph Curry not totally square feet to the basket. A lot of teams are teaching that now. A bit of a foot turn to the left if you're a right-handed shooter. I don't want both toes pointing at the basket anymore. I want a little bit of a turn. It's a natural position for your body. And it's what I started teaching a few years ago was to, you know, shoulder square everything else, but a little bit of a turn with your feet. And like you said, that's what Steph Curry does.
If you're a young kid and you want to emulate someone in the NBA, I would... In my expert opinion, I would say it'd be Kawhi Leonard. I don't. That's just for both ends of the floor.
Hey, who picked Kawhi Leonard in the draft?
Indianapolis, I believe.
Indiana Pacers, yes. But they didn't decide not to keep him. They brought back the hometown hero. And
Popovich saw something in that kid.
Yes,
and
that's
he
true.
Was right.
George Hill is an excellent player, but
absolutely.
I'll take Kawhi Leonard. And Keith Gate can get the set. Coming into the game for Ricky Volsey. His first minutes here on the floor. 103-76. Millrat lead. No big lead here for the Millrats, but like I said, 10 minutes left in this game. And James Justice back on the floor. So plug in that microwave.
Oh.
Hit start. And Gaten making an immediate impact, going after that board, keeping it alive. Millrats basketball.
Now, I wonder how many young children out there watching the game are going to be emulating some of these players, too, as their heroes, because I think we have some real athletic talent out here.
Well, you know, hey, a lot of kids come to this game, and you see them walking around with Anthony Anderson shirt on, Anthony Stover shirts on,
exactly.
Gabe Freeman shirts on, et cetera, et cetera, and they try to... you know, I'm sure they go to the playground and they try to do the things that they're seeing their local heroes do.
You can't teach 6'11", though, can you?
You can't teach it. I don't know what Mama Stover did, how he got so tall, but, you know, maybe Mom and Dad are really tall. Maybe she watered them every day growing up. I'm not sure, but...
is that California water? I don't
know. Yeah. You can't teach 6'11", that's for sure.
I had a chance to meet the Plumlee family when I was out in Indiana and in Phoenix. So they go, one boy is, Miles is 6'11", another boy is 6'10".
Mason.
And the fellow just graduating from Duke is a legit seven-footer.
Seven-footer, yeah.
Yeah.
Can you imagine those boys around the dinner table?
What do you have? Two refrigerators in your house just to keep enough food there? Well, you have to start raising cattle just to feed them.
Just to feed them.
Crazy.
So Mama Stover might have been the same situation.
I think so, yeah. I don't know if Anthony's got any brothers and sisters or who are that big too, but
if they do, call him up. I don't know if he's got a brother.
Yeah, I remember hearing this story on Adams that plays for OKC, the youngest of 18 kids. 18 kids. He's the youngest from New Zealand. He's a 7'1" guy, weighs about 290. They said every meal is 5 courses. The only time coach ever sees him upset or angry is when he's hungry. He's got about a 6'5", 240-pound sister that is like gold medalist shot put. And so you can imagine the grocery bill in that New Zealand home.
Incredible.
Gabe Freeman into the game for Darius Holloman. And Gaden with a strong board and gets himself to the free throw line. I've said it before, and I'll say it again. If you haven't been to an NBL game, you have you have no idea the size of Keith Gayden until he comes over in front of the broadcast table and he gets himself ready to check into the basketball game.
We said that.
He's a monster.
And he showed a spark of that aggressiveness you were hoping that he would could show us a little bit more.
I think the only knock on Gayden, and I'm not afraid to say what I think players need to improve on. I don't care whose feelings I heard in the broadcast. If I think they need to work on something, I say what they need to work on. Gayden is probably the strongest guy in Harbor Station right now, including all the fans and players here. But there's times where I'm not gonna say he plays soft, but he's too nice. And I don't mean that I want him to be malicious and dirty.
There we go.
Great pass, great roll. Hey, you're the strongest guy in this arena. You know, stop being nice. Don't knock him down and then help him up. You know, knock him down a little harder and then let his teammate help him up. You know, kind of thing. Just, you know, don't be so nice. Guys get a layup. You know, don't let him make that layup and then get an and one. You know, foul him hard. And not in a dirty way, but foul him hard and put him to the free throw line for a couple. Hey, it all starts there, right? Contested jump shot. Force a jump shot. Get the rebound. Get out in front. And just like that, you know, three-pointer, 26, down 23. Lots of time left here.
Coach
you know,
is up. Coach Vaughn is up.
Yeah. Coach Vaughn's up. Coach McKessie is up. You're not going to win the games if you're going to let the Millrats run layups in the rest of the game, but you can run the floor and you're knocking threes down. You might counter that, but you know, if I'm a Coach McKessie, maybe I get a timeout here. Yeah, I get a timeout and say, all right, guys, by the four-minute mark, I want this down to 15. Yeah, if we get it to 15 by the four-minute mark or even by the three-minute mark, we're back in this ballgame. We give ourselves a chance to win here.
Boy, he doesn't seem to be doing it, though. I agree with you wholeheartedly, but...
That was
the nail in the coffin right there.
Yeah, definitely the nail in the coffin. Yeah, we're seeing a guy, or Famutimi, you got Ricky Bolsey running full speed off the bench to jump up in the air and shoulder block. And, you know, Famutini's a big, strong guy, but Bolsey's about runs about 6'8", 250. He's going to knock me down, I think.
Chris Smith with about 4 points and four assists in this last 2 minutes of play. Really helping the Millrats stretch that lead out.
You know, and some games, George and Zach, you see Garius Holloman come in. You see him log about 21 minutes of playing time. Or you see Stover play longer. You don't see Famutimi and Chris Smith play as much. But Coach Vaughn goes with the guys that particular night who are playing well. He gives you a little sniff early, and if you produce, you play longer in that stint, and you get in the game quicker the next quarter or the next half. And it's not necessarily like you see Garius Holloman tonight. Use him as an example. Not logging a lot of minutes tonight. It's not because he went out on the floor and played bad, but just that other guys are playing so well. And you're up to 30 points, and he's going to stay with those guys. Next game, it might very well be Garius comes in, he plays extremely well, and he gets all the minutes, and Olu sitting on the bench for extended periods of time, or Chris Smith sitting on the bench. So I think what these players have learned during the season is that it's nothing personal. if you're not playing in a, on a particular night. It's just that other guys are playing so well, and we're so deep, we can do that. And you're curious all in into the game. And what I like seeing is let Chris Smith elevate for a 6'2 guard. He gets up and he gets up strong and throws it up to Gaten. Couldn't get the alley-oop to go, but gets his rebound. The lefty, little lefty half-court shot. Pretty to watch sometimes. It's pretty to watch. You know, George, you know, we talked there. They were 10 for 20 from the three-point line in the first half. The Millrats were not on fire from the three in the second half, but they're finding other ways to score. You know, they're getting to the rim. They're getting close to this.
Well, that last breakout by Chris Smith led to the good pass. It was after a Moncton timeout, right? And they got that transition bucket. That's tough. You know, when you're a coach, you draw something up and you don't get it. You know, that's tough for Moncton.
Definitely. You know, very rare giveaway by Anthony Anderson to Gaten. Again, you know, that's, you know, what I talked about earlier. Get your body in front of the basketball. Get your body in front of the basketball, and you'll get stops. And Gaten does a great job for a big man of stopping the basketball.
And you're not going to push him out of the way.
No rap battle for it. Chris Smith leaks out.
Zach, what could you do if you were the Moncton coach to maybe turn things around here? I know there's not much time left, but to end on a positive note?
Don't give up. This is a playoff series. They're still not out of this. You're down one game, but you know your goal as the opposing teams, you know, if you split those first two games on the road, you did your job. So don't give up in the last 3-4 we got in this game. Make a note that said, hey, next game tomorrow night, we're coming back to play.
You know, great defense.
Oh, great outlet.
It all started with Ryan Smith at the defensive end. Gets Chris Smith to turn the basketball over, and Jason Cheeks gets out and runs, throws one down.
Jabs newbie in the game.
Yeah, Jabs with his first minutes in the game.
You know, Ryan is playing some significant minutes, isn't he?
He is, yeah. Here, he plays well. He's, you know, a couple turnovers in a row for the Millrats. Oh, why is he calling?
Oh, he's calling the swing.
What? All he did was try to block the shot. Wow, I just thought he was making a play at the basketball. It was, you know, unfortunate the body's blooded and he went to the floor, but it wasn't. He, you know, Famutimi just realizing now they called it unsportsmanlike. He's like, he's, you know, talking to the referee. It's like, just tried to block the shot. How's that unsportsmanlike?
Yeah, he's calling the swing.
Oh, jabs with a little sneak play, hide in the backcourt. Oh, great pass.
That's excellent interior passing, isn't it?
Very. You like that, George? I know
spacing.
That's part of your game, is that you got that spacing.
Got that spacing.
That great spacing. And
wow. A very wise man said that one time, didn't he?
He did, yes.
It's all about the spacing.
Hey, you're talking about positive notes for Moncton. They've got a few stops and
exactly.
Got out in transition and tough to beat a team that's hitting everything on a given night. You know, average 109 a night, not 122 with a couple minutes still here to go in the game.
The Mill Rats have played very well, that's for sure.
You know, and quite often, guys, when you score a ton of points in a game, when you score a lot of points over your average, you're also giving up a lot of points because you're probably scoring, in the first 10 seconds of the shot clock, you're giving the other team more possessions than they're normally getting. You just happen to be making more shots than them. So. So 94 points put on the board by Moncton. You're still holding them to 13 points under their average. They average 107 a game. I know the game's not over a couple minutes ago, but great defensive job. Usually when you play defense like the Mill Rats have tonight, you're getting out and you're running a lot more. A lot more fast breaks. You're turning them over. You're getting something else in transition besides defensive rebounding. And you know, usually when the Mill Rats struggle to score, Zach, you've seen all season that when they struggle to score is when they're giving up the world on defense and teams are walking in the paint and scoring at will. Now you're throwing the ball in from 96 feet away and the defense has their feet set at the other end of the floor. So when they're playing defense, they're putting a lot of points on the board as a result. And guys, this one all but in the books here. 122-94, 28 point lead here for the Mill Rats. You know, Garrett Holloman gets that jump shot altered. Gaten with a great block.
That is great rebound.
That is what we talked about here, what I talked about a few minutes ago about him. Yeah, you're the strongest guy in the gym.
Oh, let's great pass. Gaten with some great minutes.
You know, that's, it's playing like that gets you more minutes come next game. And, how do you not play the guy that boxes out four guys in one possession and, you know, and then runs the floor and gets the great pass? You know, I was just saying earlier, the only knock on him is sometimes he doesn't play with that strength. He's too nice sometimes, but he's never too nice when he's going after a defensive rebound, I'll tell you that. Great hop fake by Famutimi. You know, so important to keep those knees bent while you pump fake, and you can quickly get into your move. And foul on Famutimi, four personal fouls on him, but only 50.8 seconds left to go in this game. 30 point lead here for the Mill Rats, making a statement, guys, here in game one. Want to say this is how it's going to be for the rest of this series. They don't want to go five games. Hey, we get this over in three, and we get some rest.
Get a little bit of rest.
Yeah, get some rest. We get some veterans on this team. Get a couple of light practices in, and get on to the next one. And you see the Mill Rats celebrating on the bench and having a little fun with the crowd and the kids sitting behind them. And wow, Gaten following Dabs miss.
You know, he sets a pretty good pick out of the top too, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does. He sets a great pick out there. Whoever the guard is coming off that screen, they're coming off wide open. They're making you switch, and he's running to the front of the rim with a small guy guarding him. About 10 seconds left in this game, guys. Mill Rats about to wrap this one up. George, I want to thank you for coming, joining us in the broadcast tonight. Zach, as usual, thanks for coming here tonight.
It's my pleasure. I tell you, I've really been impressed with the fundamentally sound basketball, the athleticism of the players. I think it's a great show, and I certainly would encourage everybody to come out.
Oh, yeah, definitely. You know,
leave your cowbell at home. Is that good advice? I don't know.
Yeah.
Just maybe a suggestion. There we are.
Dab's putting on a little dribbling display here before that game ended. And folks, this one's in the books. 126-98. Will Rapp making a statement here. Game one of the best of five. Right back here tomorrow night for game two, and then off to Moncton. Game three and four if necessary. But the way the Will Rapp played tonight, I think, guys, you were real close to us all season long. Every game we had was close. Not anymore.
Kind of making a statement.
Making a statement.
Playoff basketball.
Yeah, this is playoff now. We're coming out. We're playing hard. We're firing on all cylinders. And like I said earlier, this Millrass team just peaking now. They didn't peak halfway through the season. Three quarters of the way through the season. A sign of a good coach is you get them to peak late in the season, and that's what Coach Bond has done. And before we go off the air here, I'm gonna try to get Coach Bond over here for a couple words. Usually you got about 100 people shaking his hand, and yeah, look at that. We made eye contact here, and we got him over here. So. So folks at home, Coach Bond joining us in the broadcast. Coach, great job tonight.
I didn't hear what you said.
I said, Coach, great job tonight.
Thank you.
How you doing?
Thank you.
Great game.
Thank you. It doesn't mean nothing. Good to get one game, but, you know, it's a best of five. They're going to come back tomorrow hungry. It doesn't mean nothing if you don't win game two. Win game one, you got to come back tomorrow. They're going to come back at us. They're going to regroup. It'll be different. We got to come back with the same energy as we did tonight on defense, and continue to move the ball and play as a team.
Yeah. Awesome. Great words spoken. Great job tonight. We were commenting on all your timeouts, how the team come out, and you made all the necessary adjustments. You had a little bit of a chess game going on, and you won the battle tonight. Great job, Coach.
Appreciate it. You know, my guys, we've been working hard in practice. I just wish we'd get some fans out here. I mean, we're busting our butts. Come on, St. John, come support us, man. We need you. All right, that's all I'm going to say. Thanks.
Right on. All right, guys, Stacey Atkinson, George Taylor, Zach Atkinson, thanks for joining us tonight. See you tomorrow night.